On my left, we have Dr. Richard Corbett, who is former MEP and currently, as well as media pundit extraordinaire, one of the most influential Britons in the European Union, as of course your active made very clear last night. Richard is part of the cabinet, one of the top advisors to Herman Van Rompuy, the president of the European Council. Opposing him, or at least speaking in a different perspective, we have Sir Stephen Wall, who is a further extremely eminent British European. Sir Stephen was permanent representative or ambassador to the European Union for the United Kingdom for many years, and is a former EU special advisor to Tony Blair when Mr. Blair was Prime Minister of the United Kingdom. So two very eminent speakers for our launch debate and discussion. We're going to start with Sir Stephen, who will ask whether the EU has passed its sell-by date, and we'll then move to Richard, who will talk about not just that issue, but whether or not we're heading for a different kind of Europe, and in particular, maybe a two-speed one. So I will now be very quiet, and I'll pass the microphone to Stephen. Thank you very much.
Alex, thanks a lot, and thanks very much for the introduction. I posed the question, okay, obviously in a provocative way, but the thought behind it was inspired by a question asked of me a few months ago by a friend who was with me in the UK representation in Brussels when we both served there in the late 1990s. And his question was really, did I think that the European Union had had its best days, that its best days were behind it rather than ahead of it. And there's a similar thought expressed in a book which David Markrand, who'll be known to many of you, a very distinguished former Labour MP, one of the early campaigners in the 1970s for Britain in Europe. And David Markrand wrote a book, I suppose 18 months ago now, called The End of the West, The Once and Future Europe, in which his basic thesis was that the European Union had worked well, when as an elitist project, i.e. a project run by elites and devised by elites, it nonetheless had, if not the democratic legitimacy conferred on it by people, at least the consent of the people of the European Union. And David's question in his book really was, is that sustainable in the form in which we've known it since the inception of the European Union, or does there have to be now, in an era when European Union is doing less well economically, and when elites do not command automatic, if any, respect, should there be some more direct form of democracy in order to sustain the European Union into the future? Of course, devising what that form of democracy might be is quite difficult, and if I recall correctly, the one kind of practical idea in the book was the possible direct election of the President of the European Council, or maybe a merged job between the President of the Commission and the President of the Council, and I'll come to that later on. Beyond that, of course, the reasons for the concern that we all have are obvious. The question which Richard will address in a minute: if the countries of the Eurozone succeed in the objectives and policies which they've set themselves, will that mean in effect that we do have a European Union of tiers rather than simply of speeds? In other words, will there be a group of countries whose policies are so integrated that in practice, those who are not part of the Eurozone, many of them anyway, will never be capable in reality, obviously in theory, but in reality, of catching up? Now that in itself obviously is a big question that we can debate. But were that the case, then obviously the issue of keeping meaningful levels of uniformity of rights and obligations would become that much harder. Now it seems to me that, I would say this as a pro-European, that nonetheless that is the best case scenario, because it would imply at the heart of the European Union a largish core of countries sufficiently integrated
to have viable economic and political policies, and there would be a recognisable form of political union of a kind that we haven't had hitherto in the European Union. But the question in my mind is, if you have that larger and more prosperous core, is that larger and more prosperous core more generous to those on the outside, or is there a greater risk that in practice they would ignore the minority as they would be able to do in terms of the weighting of votes in any formal decisions taken in the council? The worst case scenario, it seems to me, is the unmanaged exit of Greece from the Eurozone, which in those, if it were indeed unmanaged, would probably or very possibly be followed by that of others, not necessarily in logic, but because suddenly bankers I talk to think that is the way the markets are likely to react. And in those circumstances, would the EU survive? I think the answer is yes. But what are the chances that in those circumstances, even a smaller inner group would coalesce around Germany into the kind of political union that the Eurozone countries are now seeking to implement? At the very least, I think one would have to say that in those kind of circumstances, the crisis would be such that it would be harder to envisage that than it is today. And then, of course, there's the other scenario, which is perhaps as likely as the first scenario, but again, it's a matter for debate, which is what you might call modified muddling through. In other words, the mechanisms to achieve economic as well as monetary union and the politics that go with it are in place, but are imperfectly implemented. In other words, on a larger scale, the situation we saw in the aftermath of the Maastricht Treaty with the Stability and Growth Pact that was introduced, implemented, and then disregarded by the very countries that had invented it. A Belgian banker said to me a few weeks ago, before Mario Draghi had taken the measures which he had now announced, admittedly, and talking about Spain and Italy, he said, it seems to me that Spain and Italy are like two men with pneumonia, and you give them an aspirin and they feel better and they leap out of bed, but of course they've still got pneumonia. So there is a possible scenario, it seems to me, of Eurozone countries that do enough to maintain the euro, but not enough to get beyond the crisis to the situation which the members of the Eurozone aspire to. And obviously, if in, let's say, 2015, we start to get a measure of growth again in the European economy, it seems to me that the temptation to kind of hang back on what will be, in political terms, domestic political terms, very difficult measures, will increase. So the domestic politics of the Eurozone do not allow in those circumstances for a wholehearted political union in which all most economic policies are decided in common with, I would suggest, the accompanying fiscal transfers, which I believe are probably necessary to the political union, and which is an issue to which the Eurozone has not yet completely faced up. Now, of course, it may be, and some do predict this, that the kind of political union to which Europe aspires will happen over a long period of time, as it did in the United States. But there are, it seems to be, quite strong internal forces within the member states, domestic political forces, as well as regional forces. And we see those at work in our own country as we become a federal state ourselves, which perhaps point in the opposite direction. And then what of popular consent, coming back to the issue raised by David Markham? It seems to me that tinkering with the election of the President of the Commission or the Council neither answers the problem in any meaningful sense as far as electorates are concerned, nor actually in practice, because it simply creates an additional source of tension between the democratic legitimacy of the member governments on the one hand and the democratic legitimacy that would have been achieved by the President of the Council Commission on the other. And that short of a genuinely federal system in which the people of Europe elect a parliament from which a European government is chosen, and that ain't going to happen in any of our lifetimes, I would suggest, short of that, it's very difficult, I think, to think of something which is going to answer this basic conflict within the European Union between, on the one hand, the supranational and, on the other, the national level. Can national parliaments pick up some of that slack? I think this is a more interesting question than it has been, because I think there will be, with the measures that are now in train within the Eurozone, there will be a relationship between European institutions, the Commission in particular, and governments, which will have to be authorised and monitored to an extent, certainly authorised by national parliaments. So there would be a kind of contract between individual governments and the Commission, over which national parliaments will have more of a say, certainly in terms of authorization, than the European Parliament. So there are things going on which are changing the institutional landscape, whose consequences I think we can't yet see, but certainly away from the traditional triangle of the Council, Commission, and European Parliament in quite the form we have known it. So what's the answer to my question? Well, of course the answer to my question is that I don't know. None of us know. Collapse seems to me to be the least likely, because even in the kind of worst case scenario that I've described, it seems to me that a European Union would survive, and as we know, hollowed out institutions can survive and can continue to work, albeit less effectively. Is this a situation which is qualitatively different from anything we've seen before, or merely quantitatively different? It's certainly not entirely new. We've seen with Schengen, the Justice and Home Affairs arrangements, with the single currency itself, a Europe of variable geometry. The extent to which this one becomes qualitatively different does, I think, depend upon the extent to which, for the first time in the history of the European Union, we actually achieve something which Monnet would recognize as being the kind of political union to which he aspired. What would a sensible country, not part of the Eurozone, but dependent on the European Union for its international political influence and a large part of its economic prosperity, what would such a sensible country do in present circumstances? Well, at best, it seems to me, that country would try to help manage the existing process for success by being as cooperative as possible with the countries of the Eurozone, if it was not itself part of them, while clearly seeking to protect its vital interests, which might, if that country was a country like Britain, be summed up as the single market, competition policy, external trade policy, as well as foreign and security policy. And that would mean, in turn, having the political wisdom and confidence to determine what your vital interests are, rather than asserting that all of your interests are automatically vital. So that would be the best case scenario. The at worst, it seems to me that a sensible policy would simply be to wait and see. What would a foolish country do? It seems to me what a foolish country would do in present circumstances would be to hold a referendum.
Very much, Stephen. Doubtless lots to pick up on later, and with wise and foolish countries, I'm sure you couldn't possibly comment on whether or not you were thinking about the UK. We'll pass forward to Richard Corbett. Thank you, Richard.
Thank you, Alex, and thank you for your kind words just now about this mysterious award of exaggerating somewhat my influence in Europe. I think it was more flattering than accurate, but thank you nonetheless for inviting me to speak tonight. I'll start by addressing the fundamentals of this question: has the EU passed its sell-by date? And my fundamental answer is no, because the underlying reasons why our member states have created and built up this union over period of 60 years now remain in place, whatever the ups and downs of the issues of the day. Those three reasons are idealistic, pragmatic, and selfish. idealistic, goes back to the founding motivation in a continent where every generation from the fall of the Roman Empire until 1945 went out and slaughtered each other on the battlefields of Europe. We had to find a better way of doing things. Setting up this structure where we still have arguments, but across a debating chamber or a negotiating table, is somewhat better than what we used to do. Now, some say, ah, yes, but that's old hat, everyone takes that for granted. I think the award of the Nobel Peace Prize to the European Union last month was a reminder that we shouldn't take it for granted. There are certainly some parts of Europe, and I welcome our Croatian friends here tonight, where there is still an acute appreciation of the fact that the EU brings an area of stability and therefore can help bring peace to areas where conflict all too recently has been present. That reason is not going to disappear. Second, pragmatic. We are a group of, if you look at it in global terms, small and medium-sized countries that are highly interdependent, whether we like it or not. Interdependent economically, environmentally, in all kinds of ways. These are the structures we have created to manage that interdependence. That reason is not going to disappear, whatever difficulties you may have at given times on given issues. And the third reason is selfish. Let's just look at it from a British perspective, but you could take any member state. Britain's trade, most of Britain's trade, or at least half of Britain's trade, is with the rest of the European Union. It's not just a vital matter of access to that market, but of being at the table where the common rules for the common market are set and decided, to be represented, to have a voice. That is a vital national interest. All those underlying reasons remain. Arguably, in many cases, are getting stronger, certainly won't go away. And that is why the Union has, that this process of European integration has survived past setbacks. The rejection of the EDC treaty by France, the empty chair crisis where France boycotted council meetings for 6 months, Britain's PONS policy, the policy of non-cooperation in Europe that we followed for a while, where we were supposed to veto anything that required unanimity, the rejection of the constitutional treaty by France and the Netherlands. None of it at the end of the day caused the disintegration of the European Union or a total halt in this evolution towards greater integration. So for those reasons, I'm confident that the European Union hasn't passed its sell-by date. But then we come on to the second question that you mentioned, Alex. Is the EU nonetheless changing in a way that would lead to a two-tier Europe? And of course, that question arises particularly acutely in the case of Britain. We're not in the Euro, nor likely to be in the near future. We're not in Schengen. We're not in all aspects of justice and home affairs. We have a special protocol interpreting the Charter of Rights and how it applies in our country. We have a special rebate on the budget. You know, we do look as a little bit, you know, not completely in. We're not unique in all of these, respects, after all. Denmark is not in defense cooperation. Ireland is also not in all the aspects of justice and home affairs. Cyprus, UK, Ireland, and for the time being Romania and Bulgaria are not in Schengen. Italy and Spain are not in the European patents as it's currently emerging. So you can see that it's not unique for some countries not to be fully engaged in all areas of EU activity. That doesn't mean we, as such, we have a two-tier Europe. We don't have an avant-garde. We have several different arrière-garde with a different composition for each one. Sometimes just one member state, but usually just a handful, often regarded as a temporary or anomalous situation. But the Euro, of course, is more important than some of those other ones. It's not new. We and others have not been in the Euro before. It's not a new situation. But is the Eurozone deepening in a way that would fundamentally change the nature of the European Union? I'm not sure. The economic crisis, because it's a wider economic crisis than just a Euro crisis, let's not forget that Europe and North America, the Western world, are facing the biggest economic downturn since the Great Depression, if you look at the scale and length of the downturn. That has revealed shortcomings in the structure of the euro. It's revealed some shortcomings in the structure of the single market and our common rules for the common market in the financial sector. It's revealed shortcomings in national economic policies in many countries, inside and outside the euro. And the response of the European Union for those things that arise at European level has been to deepen, not just at the level of the Eurozone. We've adopted a lot of common regulation and common supervision for the financial sector at the level of the EU27. We've done a lot more economic policy coordination than used to exist at the level of the 27. But there are some things which have deepened further and may well go still further at the level of the euro. I don't think they are going to be as far-reaching as some people would like and others fear. They will be significant steps, but they are to do with the management by those countries that share a currency of their currency. I don't see why the logical conclusion of that should be, as some people argue in this country, that Britain should opt out of justice and police cooperation. What on earth is the link? I don't see it. Nor that it necessarily means a complete revision of the structure of the European Union. After all, the bulk of decision-taking in the European Union, most of what it does, even the bulk of economic policy-making, will be at the level of all 27. The single market and the common rules for the common market, that's a huge chunk of common policy-making. Means common rules on competition policy, on consumer protection, on environmental standards, on banking legislation, some aspects of employment law. All that happens at the level of the 27, not the 17. And the non-economic things, as Stephen mentioned, foreign policy cooperation, trade matters, well that is economic, police justice cooperation, working on climate change, all that is at the level of the 27. So I do not see why the fact that the deepening economic cooperation, which goes a bit further for the Eurozone on things related to the common currency, should lead us to revise or want to review the EU system as a whole. And I rest my case there.
Thank you very much.